After discussing about the amended laws under FCRA in the previous video, this video will be focusing on how it will impact the NGOs involved in several anti-national activities. Starting with the issue of Christian evangelism. To give you an idea about how serious the problem is, there are some hard facts and figures. Kerala-based Ayan Charitable Trust, the new name under which US Charity Gospel for Asia operates, has reportedly emerged on the top of the list of Indian NGOs with highest funding of ₹826 crores in the year 2015-2016. Another Kerala-based evangelical charity, Believers Church India, has received more than 1080 crores funding in the past 6 years. Karuna Bal Vikas received more than 358 crores of foreign funding from 2011 to 2014. And all this money was being diverted for conversion activities to NGOs owing allegiance to the Methodist Church, Baptist Church, Salvation Army, Christian Missionary Society and Indian Pentecostal Church. Joshua Project is a US-based NGO that has a much deeper penetration than you and I can even think of. They have a huge database of more than a billion non-Christians, which even goes to mention their caste and even minority and Adivasi status. As per the published data from the Center for the Study of Global Christianity, by the year 2000, there were 5,400 missionary agencies around the world who sent about 440,000 missionaries to foreign countries for evangelizing and proselytization. Lacks of such missionaries pursuing India as their prime target for many decades has been sufficient to make significant demographic changes in parts of India, especially in Tamil Nadu, Kerala and northeastern states and some parts of Maharashtra, Gujarat and Punjab. To give a perspective of the unseen threat, here is some demographic data representing a huge rise in the Christian population. In Arunachal Pradesh, it was less than 1% in 1971 and now it is more than 30%. In Nagaland, it rose from 52% in 1951 to more than 90% in 2011. In Manipur, it rose from 19% in 1961 to 41% in 2011. Similar is the case with several other parts of the country. Nicobar Islands have a 67% Christian population and Kanyakumari has 44.6%. Many more such demographic patterns are visible across the country, primarily in the regions where church planting and evangelism has taken place. While Christians are only 2.3% of India's population, the church owns and controls more than 20,000 educational institutions, second only to the central government, thousands of vocational training centers and around 5,000 healthcare centers. As per an estimate, the Catholic Church is the largest non-agricultural landowner in India and the worth of its holdings may run into several lakh crores of rupees. Interestingly, there is simply neither any state overseeing the church administration nor any government interference in the appointment of bishops who are wealth administrators. The Indian church acts like a state within a state in the Indian Union yet gives its allegiance to the Pope in Rome. And that's not something new for India. It started back in 1784 with the setup of Asiatic Society of Calcutta to propagate the works of propagandist and historian William Jones and to tamper the Indian historical texts. And the setup of Serampore Seminary, Calcutta by missionaries to train Indians for evangelism. Several other such institutions were started during the British rule in India. The Christian evangelism is an undercurrent not visible yet so powerful. We all as responsible nationalists need to spread this word, at least among our peers and family. We should start discussing this, so that someday in the near future, mainstream media will cover it too. In India, the Open Society Foundation funds various evangelist propagators including Harsh Mandir's Center Equity Studies who bats openly for evangelical conversions and even ridicules laws that prevent forced conversions. In the Delhi riot, speeches by Sharzeel Imam and Harsh Mandir are mentioned in the charge sheet explaining incidents leading to the riots. Delhi police charge sheet filed in Delhi riots states that Harsh Mandir with his organization Karma e Mohabbat published a report on the violence at the Aligarh Muslim University that absolved the students of all sins and peddled numerous lies against the Uttar Pradesh police. Later, of course, the entire report turned out to be a massive fraud. Harsh Mandir was seen openly working with ISI-funded campaigns and organizations, for example, his association with the Justice Foundation. Harsh Mandir was working with Ghulam Nabi Fai, who was later arrested by US authorities for working for ISI. Now, coming on to Madrasa Nexus or the Jihadis. A sting operation by India Today in 2017 had uncovered that organizations like PFI in Kerala are running an organized conversion factory with an objective to aggressively increase the followers of Islam in India. The same PFI which also funded the anti-CAA Delhi riots of 2020. Zakat Foundation, which helps Muslims to get recruited into IAS, has links to radical Islamist Zakir Naik. Nayak has also donated to Rajiv Gandhi Foundation and Rajiv Gandhi Charitable Trust, both of which are headed by INC President Sonia Gandhi. Khalid Saifi, aide of Omar Khalid and Tahir Hussain, had met Zakir Naik in Malaysia to raise funds for Delhi riots. Reportedly, Khalid Saifi also received funds from an unidentified NRI living in Singapore other than Zakir Naik. The money was then transferred to an NGO run by Omar Khalid and his partner in crime. As per data of 2017, Waqf properties or Aukaf as they are called are spread over 6 lakh acres across the country with an estimated market value of 1.2 lakh crore according to the Minority Affairs Ministry. Now regarding NGOs, let's take the recent example of Amnesty India.
It received permission under FCRA only once in 2000, 20 years ago. So, Amnesty started utilizing commercial methods to evade FCRA provisions to receive foreign funding and work through four non-FCRA registered companies: Amnesty International Foundation, Amnesty International India Private Limited, Indians for Amnesty International Trust, and Amnesty International South Asia Foundation. Not just in India, but Amnesty was accused of similar violations in Ireland, Russia, Myanmar, Azerbaijan, and Nepal as well. Terrorism. Former Amnesty International gender head Geeta Sehgal accused it of supporting terror groups in like Al-Qaeda and Taliban. In 2013, Amnesty International admits links to activist Abdul Tehman bin Umair Al-Nuami accused of funding Al-Qaeda. It also admits ties with Taliban supporter Mozambique, and in 2015 in UK, Amnesty director had links to global networks of radical Islamists, Muslim Brotherhood and Hamas organization. Hindu phobia. Amnesty India head Akar Patel is accused several times of spreading fake Hindu terror narrative and calls for violence against Brahmins and incites Muslims to demand a separate electorate. Environmental activism. India has huge reserves of copper and aluminium, but due to environmental activists, most of the copper and aluminium extractor plants under NALCO, BALCO, CIL are shut. It was done with the motive of making raw material costlier in India, forcing us to import most of it, which will slowly stop the progress of our country. The closure of UK-based Vendetta Resources Sterlite copper plant at Thuthukudi in Tamil Nadu has affected domestic production of refined copper, while impacting its imports and exports. CARE Ratings September 2019 report said that drop in domestic production of copper had led to a domino effect, increasing imports and pairing exports. Even a former Union Cabinet Minister, P. Chidambaram, once said in the Parliament that government has no clue where the most of the foreign funds go.
Whatever we just said is just the tip of the iceberg. The nexus is too big and cannot be eradicated in one single blow. It will be a process lasting several years, and to make it happen, we the nationalists need to be united. In the next video of this series, we will be discussing about the Open Society Foundation and Ford Foundation, their links with the National Advisory Council, Rajiv Gandhi Foundation, Indian National Congress and the Aam Aadmi Party. And how are they working against the nationalists and promoting the communist ideology in the country? The next video shall be out within the next 48 hours after the upload of this video.
So make sure you like our page so that you don't miss the further updates in this series.